Welcome you all to this Zoom conversation with our wonderful guest who I'll introduce in a couple of minutes. We typically have people come into the monastery three times a year for what we call Benedictine days. And actually, Sister Michaela, who is with us tonight, was one of our first speakers at our first Benedictine days that we had pre-COVID in the monastery. So we've started this series in a way to draw people together, to reconnect with people, and to talk about some very important things that are happening in our world today in light of Benedictine values. So we're glad you're here. Thank you for being here. Thank you for taking the time. We're going to begin today by, I'll be introducing Sister Michaela, and then Sister Michaela and I will engage in some conversation. And if you have a comment or a question as she and I are exchanging conversation, you have a chat button at the bottom of your screen, and you should have a raise hand thing that you could click on also. And the raise hand, we'd prefer for you to wait till later on when I indicate it's time for that, but that'll actually allow you to speak if you would rather speak your comment or question. But in the meantime, as she and I start the dialogue tonight, if you have any comments or questions, if you would just put them in through that chat function, and I'll be watching that as the evening goes along. So here we are with Sister Michaela Hedekin. The title for tonight is A Benedictine Response for Our Time. And we have this wonderful guest with us tonight who is very steeped in the Benedictine life. Currently, she is the director of Oblates for her community, which is the Sisters of the Order of St. Benedict in St. Joseph, Minnesota. She also serves in retreat ministry and as a spiritual director. But there's quite an extensive history behind where she finds herself now. She has deep ties to the Duluth area. She was born in Virginia, and I know the sisters here at St. Scholastica just hold you dearly in their hearts.
By them.
Yes, and many of them are with us tonight, which is very, very exciting. She was taught by Benedictines from St. Scholastica Monastery in Duluth in grade school. And then her family moved to Eau Claire, Wisconsin, where she attended a Benedictine staffed high school and joined a community there in Eau Claire, the Sisters of St. Bede Monastery, during her senior year in high school. And she made her first monastic profession in 1964, her perpetual monastic profession in 1967. She came back to St. Scholastica in Duluth to go to college. She studied education. She also holds two master's degrees, one in religious education from Seattle University and the other in theology, monastic studies from St. John's University in Collegeville, which is where I also worked on my master's degree. She has served as a middle school and high school teacher. She also has served in a national capacity with Benedictines as the president of, or excuse me, your federation here, of the Federation of Saint Benedict. She was also prioress of her monastery in Eau Claire from 2008 until 2010, when that community made the decision to join into the community in St. Joseph, the Sisters of the Order of St. Benedict, where she is now. And a year after her Eau Claire community joined with the monastery in St. Joseph, she was elected prioress there. Mm-hmm. Where she served for 6 years from 2011 to 2017. So I know a lot of the Benedictines there in St. Joe, and so I did a little more research on Michaela. So I have some fun things to share with you. So I'm told that one of your favorite quotes, Sister Michaela, is, if you've met one Benedictine, you've met one Benedictine.
Yeah, that's true.
And I'm told you're really one of a kind. Another of your phrases that you use a lot is more often than not. More often than not, we are this way or that way. We'll be at prayers, we'll be kind, we'll be generous, but you allow for the element of human mistakes in that phrase with your compassion, your goodness, and a heart as big as the world. That you make life fun and you see the brightness all the while also being a realist. That Sister Michaela is a bridge builder, a voice of unity, peace, and collaboration. And another little note, I heard your father was a car salesman.
He was.
And that he could talk anyone into buying a car. And so I'm told that you can talk anyone into being a Benedictine. while still graciously allowing them to be able to say no. So I wish that all of those in attendance with us right now could welcome you with thunderous applause, Sister Michaela. But we welcome you and are so grateful you're here at this deeply transitional time in our lives.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so thank you. So I think that you were going to open us with a prayer.
Absolutely. Prior to which, I want to offer a very heartwarming thank you for inviting me to be with you and for your very kind words. It's a real gift to be here tonight to be able to share. The Benedictine heritage is something I hold very dear and have a great desire to hand it on. So with that in mind, we place ourselves in the presence of God who holds us as we come together virtually and otherwise. And we place before God all of the intentions in our heart, the needs of our world, our country, our church, our families, and individually what it is we need most as we pray. Gracious and holy God, give us the wisdom to perceive you, the diligence to seek you, the humility and patience to wait for you, eyes to behold you, a listening heart to meditate upon you, and a life to proclaim you through the power of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. That was beautiful. Beautiful way to begin. Yeah, before we dig into some really deep stuff, Sister Michaela, I noticed that in the bio that's on our website that you sent to us, the last line says that you enjoy spending time with people, reading, music, movies, being in nature, that these are all sources of enjoyment for you. And I'm not quite sure where you get time for all of that, but
I find time.
During the pandemic, how have you been nourishing yourself? What are you reading? What are you listening to? What are you watching?
The last of the pieces that I shared was just being in nature is one of the things I find very renewing. And we're so very gifted here on the campus of St. Benedict's to just have beautiful grounds, trails in the woods, And so I have really spent a lot more time out walking and being held in nature to try to get grounded again in the midst of the chaos that I think all of us are feeling in varying degrees and for different reasons. Music is another one that I just love. I find different pieces of music that will try to touch the mood that I'm trying to express so that it doesn't just rattle around inside of me, which I think is really important. And of course, our life is so grounded in prayer, which really is the framework for our day. And my own time, I'm an early riser. I've always been an early riser. I don't need a lot of sleep, fortunately. And that quiet time in the morning, again, is something that is just profound for me. As well as gathering then three times a day, at least with the community to pray. So it's a whole variety. I like to read a variety of different things, a lot of periodicals, because I think they really center on some of the ways to take a look at what's happening in our world today. So many of them, interestingly enough, are revolving around what Benedict does have to offer in terms of the very things that people are searching for and not feeling, such as community because of the pandemic, or community because that's maybe feeling a little bit not what it once was for us because we have different views of and opinions of what's happening in the world. And I try to not use the word divisive because I think that only divides us. You know, we're viewing things differently and we need to learn to talk about them. And so I think there again, that the being in community helps me be able to be grounded as I visit with others that are really searching and struggling for what they need and what they want and what they're looking for in life, as well as in responding to the times, as Benedict has shown us. Right now, a new book on the wisdom of Benedict has just come out, and I'm just beginning to move through that, which is, I mean, it's just really literally hot off the press this fall. And so that's been very good. But I always like to have a novel going also. And I've been just finishing off the second book again of Gregory Boyle's Barking to the Choir. It's light, but it's also dealing with people who have transcended sometimes and sometimes not transcended the chaos of their life. And his approach to how to be with them, I have found very helpful in simply doing that and being with those that are struggling at this time. Or trying to find a way to move through all that's happening in our world. So that's a little bit of what I find. Not able to get to movies, and every now and then I may watch a DVD right now, but that's probably on the sideline. I read about them though, what the movies are that are coming out. I think if Jesus were to come today, he would make movies instead of telling parables.
Yeah. You know, I just want to go back for just a second when you were talking about prayer. I was really captured by that. And I'm aware of Ignatius, who certainly wasn't a contemporary Benedict, but drew on lots of Benedictine wisdom. Mm-hmm. And he would say that when we are in a time like we are in now, that we should not change. We should not make big changes in our practices, particularly of prayer. In fact, we should pray more.
Yes.
And so I'm just kind of wondering if you have changed any prayer practices during the pandemic.
I haven't changed any practices as such. I would say that my time has gotten longer. You know, I thought to myself the other day, if I get up any earlier, I probably don't really need to go to bed, which I know would not be real wise, and I won't do that. Benedict was big on moderation, and I keep having to work on that. Yeah. One of the things I have found myself doing is expanding the prayer, the time that I pray, but also expanding the people for whom I am praying. I'm very conscious of, we have like many communities do, we have a section on our website where people can give their intentions for praying. Mm-hmm. And one of our sisters, that's one of her responsibilities, would be to respond to these people when they ask us for prayers, and then to let the community know who the people, the first name of the people, because they don't always give their full names. Many of them are anonymous, but what it is, what the intentions are that we're praying for. And so that's extended my prayer time in terms of including these people and trying to picture them. It's a sacred experience for us to have people entrust us with their concerns and their deep, deep needs and the tragedies of their lives. And we take that very seriously here. You know, some people call in rather than writing in, and then those are all posted on a board, as they say, it is in almost every community that I know. And so spending time at the board each day, expanding that prayer to include these people. And then as I'm walking around, as I am out in nature, also remembering, oh, now this is the one that we want to pray for today, or that one's having this happen. Mm. So it's also expanded my not getting caught up in, oh my word, I wish things were a little different, and I had a little bit more ability to tend to the things I wanted to tend to, because I can't be with the people that ordinarily I might be spending time with. Even retreats that I've done this year, I did 3 Zoom retreats this summer when I would have been ordinarily with the religious communities, with the Benedictine communities. But you adjust and adapt, and you find new ways to do it.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for that. That's something I'm going to think about myself, to just how you express that. That was very beautiful. Let's turn a little bit to the world and to what Benedict might say or be in this world. What is it you see and sense happening today, and how do you situate yourself in this world as a woman, as a Benedictine, as a believer? What are you seeing?
I'm seeing a great deal of a variety of ways in which people are struggling and hurting. And I'm also profoundly touched and deeply grateful for the people who are responding. We have many of our sisters who have relatives that are doctors or nurses that are on the front line. Today, I was just visiting with somebody who said that their community member works with funeral directors. And right now, they're classifying them as people on the front line, because they're just overpowered by all that they're tending to and trying to be present to. So I see in the world today, what we see as you and I have talked before, what we see in the opening of the scriptures in the book of Genesis, I see a lot of chaos. And chaos always, when we have to remember that, though it may be difficult, it always precedes creation. And so I don't think it's a matter that one happens and the other happens. I think the chaos is leading us to creation. It's leading us to an awareness of the possibility. We make the choices, but the possibilities of reaching out to others, which is so very Benedictine. You know, Benedictine the rule, as he's putting forth what we today call Benedictine values, which are really the gospel values that he wove into the rule in a way that they support us as we live together in community. And they're applicable to friends. They're applicable to neighborhoods. They're applicable to families, to parishes or congregations. We just live them probably a little bit more closely. And I think that, you know, the simple things that Benedict tells us, never turn away when someone needs your love. And we just have multitude opportunities to do that and to find very creative ways to be able to reach out, to not turn away. From reading the newspaper to watching what's happening on television, that we then connect with these people in prayer. If we know them, we call them. You know, there's just a whole variety of ways of what we're seeing. I'm seeing a lot of fear. I'm seeing a lot of desire for community. And I think they're very much related. And I think Benedict sees them as very much related.
Huh, how so? Could you speak more to that?
From my perspective, Benedict starts the rule, as we all know so well, with the word listen. And I think what's happening with the fear that is so prevalent in our world today, and in our own country especially, very often I find that it's because we haven't listened all the way through to hear where people are coming from, particularly, as I mentioned, with the variety of opinions people have today that can be very difficult for families, for example, that within a family, there can be a whole variety of views and opinions about what should be being done or what shouldn't be being done. And the tendency that many of us have is to move to trying to convince the person that that's not right and my way is right and listen to my opinion, rather than our finding out. One of the questions I love asking people is just simply, now tell me about what brought you to believe that. Mm. You know, what helped you to have that opinion? What story in your life was influential in you coming to understanding the stance that you're taking right now? And then to sit back and let them tell that story. Then I'm not so fearful of, you know, where they are, because I understand it better. And they become less fearful of me, because we're all fearful of being judged or being told that, you know, what we're thinking is wrong. You know, obviously at times, if it's a moral issue, we need to tend to that. But very often it's just a different way of looking at things. You know, as you mentioned, I taught middle school and high school, and what I taught was science and religion. And I used mm-hmm. to love to teach the children, when I was teaching the sections on lenses, about a concave and a convex line. And I would put an X on the inside of the concave line, and I'd say, now, if you're standing here, what is this line? And they'd say, concave. And then I'd put an X on the other side, and I'd say, what is the line here? And they'd say, convex. And I said, it's the same line. Mm. And see, we need to start taking a look at, very often, we're holding pieces, if not a whole perspective, that we're just looking at differently. And we have to move to a sense of not fearing that difference and finding out about that difference and what is the connector in the midst of that difference. And I think, you know, Benedict was very clear about that too. You know, he brought together in a time that was very much like our own. The Roman Empire was crumbling. You know, Rome had been sacked a number of times by the time he was even born. And he brought together peasants and freed people and the clergy, you know, people who had been ordained and people who were educated and people who had no education. And somehow he was able to form community from that. But I think it was because he taught us how to trust and not to fear each other, which is a long, long process. It doesn't happen overnight. And it wasn't a straight shot for him. He didn't, you know, more often than not, he was not really finding what it was that he was hoping for. He went to Rome to study, and it was so, it was such a situation that he really couldn't stay there because it was so horribly immoral that he just walked away from it. So, you know, he had to try new things and move in different directions and be open to changing what he thought it was going to be. Mm.
You know, that's fascinating. And I was thinking as you were talking that when you came and did our first Benedictine days mm-hmm. two years ago this past September.
Yeah, with Abbot John.
Mm-hmm. With Abbot John, the title of your talk was Navigating the Chaos. Right. And I was just thinking, you know, and we thought we were in chaos then.
Oh, yes.
When I look at what we're facing now, but this fear piece, you know, and I see that so much too. All you have to do is turn on the TV or open up a newspaper, read an article online. What do you think Benedict might, I know this is probably the million dollar question. What's at the root of that fear? What's happening? Why, you know, I think about our country and our inability to dialogue sometimes. What is at the root?
I think a big piece of it is our lack of trust. Number one, to trust God, that God is working in all of this, to trust ourselves that we can deal with it by God's grace, and to trust that other people, by and large, again, more often than not, are doing the best they can. And then to start from that basis in terms of conversation or in terms of reaching out or in terms of being aware of what's happening in other people's lives. Mm-hmm. You know, trust is a big issue. And, you know, some of the studies show that trust in our major institutions today, as we well know, has been terrifically compromised because of people not living up to what they said they would be and would do, and living up to the values that we've all held sacred. And we're in a time now where we have the opportunity to really grab hold of that and to really take a look at, well, what is important in our life? And by what values do I want to live? And this is, again, where I feel so blessed to have the values and the understanding from what Benedict has really seeped into my bone marrow because of the tremendous education I've had through my sisters at St. Scholastica's. To engage those values and that understanding, and to really run the risk of trusting. Will it always be met with success? No, but we learn from those opportunities. We learn how better to navigate it.
You know, I'm thinking about this article I looked at last week, and it was out of Forbes. And it was named the 20 happiest countries in the world. And what struck me was the criteria that they used to judge, you know, for people to say how happy they were. And by and large, the first one on the list was always knowing that I can count on other people to have my back, to help me. So when we talk about fear and responding with trust, what might that look like? What would Benedict say that it looks like? Yeah. What does that look like?
Diana, it's a very interesting image that I only recently, it was brought to my attention by a Benedictine sister in Atchison, Sister Judith Cetera, who was giving a reflection a few weeks ago. And she was talking about the fact that, as I just mentioned, Benedict brought together, is what we might say in kind of pedestrian terms, a motley crew. Mm-hmm. And of course, in that day and age, even in the day and age when I first entered, the monks all slept in a dormitory. Benedict said you should always see the candle glowing so that they have light, and a senior seasoned monk should always be with them. But one of the interesting things that's kind of very often missed in the rule, as Judith pointed out, was that he says that they should take off their knives. Now think about that for a minute. You know, and he says lest they should cut themselves. Anyway, he was very concerned about that. But it was also, I think, as Judith pointed out, and I agree with her, that it was a trust issue. It was a real trust issue. They were sleeping with people they didn't know. And that's what the uniqueness about Benedict is that he brings us together in community where strangers are living together. You know, I didn't know the people I came to entered with in Eau Claire. I didn't know I knew who they were, and I had gotten to know some of them. But we come sight unseen, and it's not love for each other that brought us together. It's love for Christ.
Yeah.
And that is the center for Benedict, is how do we love Christ together? Mm. So that putting aside the knives is really saying something to me, because, you know, unfortunately, think of the number of people who sleep with guns at their sides now on their bedstand. And I've heard of them. I think we've all heard of them. We have more guns here in the United States now than we have people. And I'm you know, I'm certainly not against guns. Again, it's Benedict's moderation, but I think for Benedict, it looks, as your question asked, it looks like taking off your knives.
Mm.
You know, it looks like being vulnerable with each other. Yeah. My trust in you enough to even let you know I'm fearful.
We have an interesting question that came in from Therese Tamanek. As we get older, how do we prevent getting more fearful? Why do you think this happens to us?
As we get older, we prevent getting more fearful?
No, how do we prevent?
Well, how do we prevent getting more fearful?
Yeah. Why do
you? Well, being someone who is a little older myself, you know, with this pandemic, I keep saying, you know, I live in a house of vulnerable adults, and I am one of them. I think, and that's one of the things I love about having an intergenerational community. Our oldest sister just died this year. She was a dear friend of mine at age 104. And the wisdom that our senior sisters have is just, it's such a treasure, just such a treasure. And I see many of them, particularly, I would use this sister as an example. I see many of them as she grew older, things fell away. What was really important became much more important to her, and not the side things that as we're younger become important. I think being fearful as we get older is basically being fearful of two things, the unknown and not being in control, which is typical for all of us at any generation. But, you know, it's the classic of the scriptures where Jesus says to Peter, when you were young, you would go where you wanted to go. But when you were old, another will belt you and take you where you would not go. And I like that translation, will belt you and take you where you would not go. You know, even as I spent time with our sisters in the nursing home, you know, the gate belt is a safety device, but you're belted taking where you wouldn't want to go. And I think it's the prayer for us that becomes then, dear God, I am fearful. I no longer have control, and the control keeps going. We keep having to let go of it. I have, you know, no longer do I know what might even be happening. And I move into trusting you. And even when I don't trust you, my prayer is, dear God, when I begin to fear, in you do I seek to trust. I may not be quite there. And I'm always reminded, because I think what goes with the fear is the anxiety. And we know right now, that's the other pandemic we're dealing with from young to old, is the anxiety level is just almost becoming insurmountable. But I'm reminded of Thomas Merton back in the 60s, and the 60s were as tumultuous in their own way. John Lennon used to say, anybody who remembers the 60s didn't live through them. I did, and I do remember them. But Thomas Merton had an interesting thing. He said, you know, anxiety is inevitable in an age of crises like ours. God doesn't ask us not to feel anxious, but to trust God no matter how we feel. And my prayer has become, dear God, you know I want to trust you. Please don't look at my stomach that's doing cartwheels. Look at my heart. You know what I want. And I think that too, I find when I get fearful, helps me. It really helps me. The other thing, interestingly enough, that really ties the pandemic to the other area that we're really dealing with that brings a lot of fear and our need for community is the racial unrest. And I'm very touched and have spent some time prayerfully reflecting on the reality that what really brought this to a head for us right here in Minneapolis was the George Floyd situation, where the line is, I can't breathe. And now the pandemic is centered on breathing. People who contract it and move into a dying state, that is what they can't do, is breathe. And yet for those of us who are seeking to find some dimension of letting go of the fear of trying to tap down the anxiety, that's something we can engage. It has been shown that deep diaphragmatic breathing is one of the finest things you can do for anxiety, for fear, and even for pain. And so I highly recommend that to people. Just time, taking long, deep breaths diaphragmatically. So you're really, you know, really filling your lungs up, slowly exhaling. And one of the things that they have come to, some of the research has shown, it's much better to do that by inhaling through your nose and exhaling through your nose. But make the exhalation longer, as long as you can possibly make it, than the inhalation. So the very thing that we're dealing with racially and the pandemic, the fear that we are finding, you know, what this woman was asking in terms of how do we deal with that as we get older, breathe. You know, the breath of God was what we find in that creation. You know, we went from chaos to the creation, and the center piece of God's creation was human beings into whom he would breathe. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, part of the answer is right there for us.
One of the things I was going to ask you was, how do we pray in the midst of chaos? How do we listen to God? And it strikes me that starting with some of that breathing may be a way.
That is a prayer.
Yes.
That is a prayer. And sometimes just the name of Jesus is a prayer. Mm-hmm. Just slowly. You know, one of the things, and it's funny that I didn't come to it earlier, but I would say within the last 3-4 years, realized that the last syllable of Jesus' name is us.
He's us.
Wow. And if we need anything right now, we need, you know, it's the TV show, This Is Us. And this is us. And Jesus is the one that does make us us.
So
just the name of Jesus being prayed, you know, so often, as I mentioned, one of my very treasured ministries was that of being with our sisters in the nursing home. It was a public nursing home when we were in Eau Claire for 6 years. And so I have been with many sisters as they were going home to God. And just to say that name of Jesus, to find the hymns that have Jesus' name in it, can be very, very comforting. And so to find, it doesn't have to be long. Again, you know, Benedict was very clear about prayer and community doesn't need to be long. You do want to make it long, pray by yourself. But I think he would also say it doesn't have to be long when you're praying by yourself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So how do we pray at this time? We pray very gently with ourselves. We pray very broadly, however. Mm-hmm. That it's not just about me, it is about us. And it is about Jesus bringing us together. The rule, again, is so Christocentric. It's just centered on Christ. It's all about Christ. And I think that too is a real clue for us that needs to be the center of our prayer. How do we be anointed by this Christ that is the cosmic Christ that's holding the world and creating something out of this chaos that we may never live to see, but I want to be a part of it. You know, I want to bring goodness and kindness and gentleness and love to it.
Right. And I'm struck too that, you know, as the pandemic has raged on and is raging on even more now, this sense of liminality that we can feel and like, almost holding our breath and waiting for it to be back to normal, right? But when we, you know, there's a lot of theologians that are writing now that, and I'm curious what Benedict might say about this, but the idea that what is normal and that if we are always evolving and changing, maybe there is no normal. We're becoming. We are always becoming. So to be able to breathe in the midst of change and chaos with some order also, you know, like you walking out in nature, it kind of restores that sense for us and me here in Duluth over the lake. So yes. How would Benedict respond to talking about, you know, continuing chaos in order, just like at the beginning of creation?
In my own heart and mind, I think this is one of the things that Benedict gave us in the way of life that he laid out for us, is that you need that order. You need a framework. And as I said earlier, I think for us, that's what the prayer life does. But he said, you find, as he's laid out the way that we are to live together, you find it in the daily. It's in the simple, whatever you're called to do, and whether it's serving, which he calls all of us to do, we all take our turns serving the meals, or it's washing the towels after people have been, you know, served. It's about whatever we are called to do, always with a kind word. You know, one of the things whenever anybody says something to me about normal, I'm reminded of the joke that many of you, I'm sure, have heard, but I think is really true, that normal is nothing more than a setting on the washing machine. You know, normal is something that is kind of a figment of our imagination. Now, those of us who grew up in the happy days of the 50s, yeah, that was probably normal, but it wasn't very real either. I mean, it was wonderful. But, you know, we also know that it has some backdrops that were pretty painful for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And so I think what is normal is what I'm called to be and do in this given moment at this given time, in whatever my life is calling me to, whether it's doing the dishes or taking care of one of the sisters that's sick or getting her to a doctor appointment or whatever it may be, or listening to somebody who's just struggling and not trying to take the pain away, but being present to her in that pain, or walking with him in the confusion of wherever this person may be, simply listening to them. You know, the ways that we find to reach out to each other right now are going to be just so important, whether it's a simple note to write to somebody or a telephone call, you know, whether it's somebody we find out in our parish that we know that, you know, that somebody in the parish knows that they're alone, that we can somehow connect with. You know, there's just a variety of ways that we can be there for them.
So if we center our understanding of normality in how we engage and interact with others, with creation, then it doesn't matter what's going on out there.
It
matters, but not in the way that it affects us in here.
Precisely. It doesn't throw us off balance. We may have days that it throws us off balance, and that's important, because we need to, otherwise if it didn't, we would forget that God was really the one in charge. You know, but I think that we stay centered and we stay grounded, and you can't do that without a relationship with our Lord, with God, however you may know or experience God, it's consistent and it's daily, and it's permeating throughout the day in terms of how we are with each other, or how we are reaching out to, you know, those of you who are with us tonight and are all alone, you know, for one thing, you need to let us know who you are, and you know, we want to connect with you. But do know that we are connected with you by prayers, because we pray, as I know the sisters at St. Scholastica and other communities do. We pray for people who are struggling in this pandemic, people who can't be with their loved ones, people who are caring for the loved ones. You know, it's almost, in the best sense of the word, a game of how many people can I think of to pray for. Just reading the newspaper, these are people we need to pray for. And along with that is being sure that we're finding good news too. I love good news, because that buoys us up. The wonderful story the other day I saw on television, I love CBS Sunday Morning, I only get to watch a glimpse of it. Story of a little girl who had cancer, she was probably about 4 years old, and the sign out in front of her house is, no candy tricks or treaters here, because there's a child with cancer in the house. And the film, the camera that was out in front of the house for the parents to be sure who was coming, captured children coming from all over this little town, bringing their candy for this little girl and dropping it off underneath the sign. They interviewed one of the little girls and they said, well, what did you do? And she said, well, I gave all of my candy because I wanted to reach out to her. Now we need to search out those stories, and we need to share those stories.
I wish they were the headlines, right?
We need to make them the headlines. Yes, yes. Yeah. Our media has a way to go. They have a way to go to help us.
Well, I'm going to turn to the attendees at our event now and invite any of you who would like to send us a question by chat, question or comment. Mm-hmm. Or you can also raise your hand, and I will see that on my end. So go ahead and do that, those of you who are participants. And while we're waiting for some more to come in, there was one here that says, I would like to hear sister's thoughts on my new favorite quote for our time from Joseph Campbell. Quote, if you want to change the world, change the metaphor.
Whoa, absolutely. Absolutely. I think I would point to that. I would agree with that totally. And I think part of what pushes forward the metaphor are the words we use. I think we have to be very, very careful at a time like this in regard to the words that we use. You know, as I mentioned earlier, I don't like using the word divisive. Yeah. Yes, the country's at a point where we've got a variety of opinions, but if we keep saying we're so divided, that's the mindset out of which we're going to operate.
Such a great point. Yes.
I think the words we use are just so terribly important. Talking about this in terms of chaos, always put it with creation. We are in the midst of chaos. It's leading us to creation. Mm-hmm. And I hope I can stick around to see it. So I would just invite everybody. I would agree with the quotation, and thank you for bringing it forward. I don't know that I'd really ever heard that, though I love Joseph Campbell. The words we use create the images out of which we operate. Mm-hmm. And that is very much, I believe, what leads to the fear and the lack of trust and breaks down community.
Yeah, I was talking with someone yesterday who was saying, we're beyond the election and it's time for us to look at ourselves, no matter which side we were on, and to reflect on whether our behavior was kind or not.
Absolutely.
Because that's the only way to move forward. Yeah.
And were our words kind? Were our words kind?
Yes.
It doesn't mean that we agree with what people are saying or doing, but there's, again, the story behind why they are saying and doing it. Mm-hmm. And, the big thing when I would find myself in the midst of people who are, maybe being less than what I would call kind, I would just simply say, we need to pray for him. We need to pray for her. And I think that just is a good reminder. Sure, you run the risk of being a goody two-shoes, but I think it's a risk that's important to take because it does, we've got to level up our conversation. We really do. And again, I think this is what, one of the chapters in the rule that Benedict has is on restraint of speech, not on silence. In the original translations, it was called on silence, but it's called on restraint of speech. And again, I think we need to think about what we're saying before we say it and the words we use, because we do need to talk, we do need to share, we do need to ask each other, tell me more about what you're thinking, explain that to me.
Yeah, it's a fine line, isn't it? Because
it's a very delicate dance is what I call it.
It is, because we need to be able to be who we are. Mm-hmm. Yet at the same time, that doesn't give us license to be, vicious or intemperate. Right. Yeah. Right.
And I think that's, again, part of what Benedict shows us as he's taking it from the Gospels, is the great respect that Jesus had for everyone, as well as the great respect that Benedict calls us to. And I am a lover of etymology, and the word respect simply means to look again. Mm-hmm. We can respect people when we look again. And we don't just take the surface, we tend to judge by what we're seeing. And so that respective person is so important. And Benedict does it in a variety of ways. He says we should listen to the young. They sometimes have the best. And look at what our young people, they're leading the way in the whole dimension of climate change, in terms of how we handle the whole gun situation. I'm proud of our young people. And Benedict knew that. Listen to them. Yeah. And we don't always do that. Great respect for what people needed. People were not, by Benedict's way of living, our living together, we're not supposed to all get the exact same thing. We're supposed to get what we need. And if you don't need as much, be grateful. And if you need more, be grateful. See, I think gratitude is another important part of all of this right now. How do we find, in the midst of all the limitations we're facing, things to still be grateful for? Mm-hmm. And then how do we express that in prayers of gratitude? Being a Benedictine, I find that in the Psalms. Mm. Psalms have been a mainstay for me these months, my whole life, but especially these months. On the down days, you can find a psalm that's going to get you through it. on the days when it's going well and you want to thank God, there's beautiful psalms thanking God. And they've been prayed for generations, for eons. They express humanity.
It's interesting too, like the Psalms of Lament, and I'm also thinking of one of the things I do if I'm feeling really sad, and there's actually research behind this, that if we listen to sad classical music, it actually helps us.
Yeah. One of my favorite pieces.
Same with the Psalms. Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. And one of my favorite pieces is Rhapsody in Blue.
Oh.
Yes. I would love to be able, before I die, to play it. Now, I can't play the piano, so I've got a long way to go. But who knows? You know, I never say never anymore.
Right. We have one comment that's come in from Therese. Again, she says, I keep nodding my head in agreement and delight.
Oh.
Thank you so much for your wisdom, Dawn and thank Sister you. Michaela.
Thank you.
Therese, that was beautiful. And speaking of young people, we have a comment from, or a question actually, from Greg Spofford, back where I hearken from in Little Falls. Okay. And he says, Sister, your community is closely linked to the good students of CSB and SJU, the College of St. Benedict and St. John's University. How are you and your community engaging these neat young people? Greg and Vicky.
Wonderful question, and I'm just delighted to be able to tell you that I just was on a Zoom meeting with one of them today and have been on a number of them. We have a Benedictine Friend program where our first year students can have a sister be a Benedictine friend, that they know that we're always here if they need us. And so we've been Zooming with our Benedictine friends. We've got a program that our president will be doing with them all by Zoom next week. We're right in the midst, even as we speak, of a busy women's retreat. And I'm partaking in that. And so I'm meeting every day and journeying with a first year student who wanted to spend some time in retreat during these days. So we're basically doing it virtually. Some are doing it FaceTime and some are doing it by phone. We can, you know, take treats and send them through the mail because we've got the interlinking mail to get them to their mailbox. Yeah. So some of them are, you know, some of us are trying to get the Halloween little treats out to them the other day. I know some of the sisters have made cookies and sent them over. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we're very limited because we are a house of vulnerable adults that we can't have the students come to be with us, which we usually are able to do. But we're finding ways.
Wonderful. Yeah, they have a similar program here too.
Yes, I know this. Most colleges that are connected to a religious community have some dimension of that, yes.
We have a comment here from Michelle who says, I think the pandemic, while it is awful in so many ways, has provided us with so many opportunities that were not present prior to this happening. Mm-hmm. I would not be able to be a part of this evening. I am in St. Paul.
Okay.
We're glad you're with us, Michelle. Yes. Yes, I have found that over and over. Has that been your experience?
Absolutely. And that's where I think we need to move that into that, very much what Michelle did. We need to move that into gratitude.
You know?
Dear God, we hate this pandemic and we are very grateful for what it's taught us.
Yeah.
You know, what it's taught us in terms of the dedication of the medical field, what it's taught us in terms of people finding interesting ways to reach out, what it's taught us in terms of things that we used to take for granted that I don't think we will ever take for granted again, ever.
I've even been very pleasantly surprised. You know, I work in a realm, you know, in education and in spirituality where we're very resistant to doing things that aren't in person. You know, it was always, no, that's second best, but it's amazing how you can really connect with people and get people to connect with one another on Zoom. Mm-hmm. So I've been grateful to, we've had people participating from all over the place.
Yes,
so,
yes.
And we have you, and we've been able to have you here with us.
Absolutely. And, you know, given that we're in the midst of a snowstorm here, and I understand you are up there too, you know, what might have happened? Yes, and I think that this is, as you mentioned, that I have the marvelous opportunity to journey with our oblates, which has been wonderful, and have been meeting many of them on different oblate groups by Zoom. But we also, as I know St. Scholastica does, we have oblates all over the world. So in one day last week, I was, you know, visiting with somebody online that lives here in the United States, somebody who's in Argentina, and somebody who's in Amsterdam. So, you know, I mean, what an enriching life. I mean, it's just absolutely.
Wow.
Yes, absolutely wonderful.
Beautiful. I have a question here from Lucy.
Mm-hmm.
How can the rule of Saint Benedict help us heal our country right now?
I would say that Benedict's call to us to be listeners. To move beyond the fear, you know, he picks that up in the chapter on humility, that perfect love moves beyond fear. You know? Now, it's not our perfect love, it's God's perfect love. Mm-hmm. And to remember that God loves us, you know, and that because God loves us, we don't need to fear. We can move out to reach out to other people. What happens with fear is that we either get so concerned about what's happening that we move to aggression because we want to be powerful and control it, or we get paralyzed and just aren't able to do anything. Mm-hmm. And Benedict, I think, again, calls us to be healed by caring for each other, by moving out to each other. The chapter 4 on the tools of good works, the tools that we take to care for each other. Never let the sun go down on your anger. Make peace before it settles. Never give up hope in God's mercy. It's phenomenal in terms of that kind of healing. But I think engaging what Benedict taught us, and when we fail, to ask for forgiveness, you know, to listen in such a way that I'm free to say, hey, I was wrong, I made a mistake. You know, we are going to be making mistakes in terms of trying to listen to each other and not always listening well and not always really hearing what's being said. But I think that that's where we start. You know, who is it? We started with ourselves. How do I need to listen to myself and hear God speaking? And how do I hear God speaking in the other person who's also there? Now, you know, I've spent a lot of time on listening tonight, but I'm just very much convinced that that's really where we are. Respectful listening, according to Benedict, is what's going to overcome fear.
Interesting.
And fear is what's caused us the tremendous hurt that we've all known.
Yes, yes.
And so I think that respectful listening, where we really give time to hearing what another person is saying and doing, and to listen to ourselves, either through journaling or artwork or saying it out loud or talking to a friend. You know, we can't just keep what we're feeling inside of us because it will just rattle around and it comes out sideways.
Yeah,
but we do need to express it, you know, the fear that we feel, the hurt that we feel, whatever it may be, but always with words of kindness. Benedict has a line in the rule where the person that what we call the seller, the person's in charge of giving out whatever is needed. If he's asked to give something that he doesn't have, or it maybe is even unreasonable, is to at least give a kind word.
Mm.
Now think about when you go to a grocery store and the cashier says something kind to you or greets you and doesn't just treat you like somebody going through the line. It makes all the difference in the world to us.
It does. It does. You know, we got a comment in from Michelle in St. Paul again, and she says, thanks so much. Your words have stilled my soul and allowed me to redirect myself toward a more centered and grounded stance.
Oh, my Irish grandmother would say, glory be to God. Thank you, Michelle.
Yes, thank you, Michelle. We are at the end of our time, and I want to extend a deep thank you to all of you that are here as attendees. You have blessed us with your presence here. Nicole writes in, thank you for making this event possible. You are welcome. Mm-hmm. It is a joy to do these. And speaking of joy, it has been a joy to have you here, Sister Michaela. I wish I could reach out and give you a big hug. And I know there's many in attendance who would like to, yes, just wrap you up. So thank you so much. I hope you all can join us. Our next Benedictine conversation will be December 10th. It's actually a Thursday, and it will be with Abbot John Clausen, and he's going to be speaking to us about Advent and keeping hope. And so we'll have emails going out regarding that and have you sign up for that, just like you did this time. And again, we are blessed by all of you being here. God bless you all. And Sister Michaela, I'm going to hand it back to you and just ask what words you'd like to leave us with tonight.
The words of the gospel tell us not to be afraid. Starts with the words to Mary and to Joseph, be not afraid. Keep repeating those words. And the reason that we aren't needing to be afraid is that Joseph is told that Jesus' name will be Emmanuel, which means God with us. We are accompanied by a God who walks with us, who has lived like us. And Benedict, I think, sums it all up in our never losing hope in God's mercy. And remembering that Matthew ends his gospel by telling us that I am always with you. So God is in the midst of all of this as we move from chaos to creation, loving and God and each other and being grateful. Thank you so very much for allowing me to share.
Thank you. Good night, everybody.
God's blessings. Take gentle care.